works. The result is that we wait to be challenged. We were fortunate because we had a couple of oceans that protected us. But the reason I'm saying don't wait for the next war now is because there are some enormous problems coming our way. And it's not just ISIS. It's not just Putin. It's the fact that the culmination of these issues will threaten our ability to lead the world and manage events the way we've all become accustomed to, really, since the end of the Second World War. We set up the United Nations, the International Monetary Fund, the World Bank, NATO, the treaty with Japan. We fought wars in Korea and Vietnam. We had the Soviet Union. Ike told us, come together. There's so much evil out there that if we're not strong, if we don't submerge the differences between Democrats and Republicans, we can't cope with the challenge posed by the Soviet Union. And it was a winning formula. It mostly worked for 40 years. Now, Democrats and Republicans never got along that well, but, you know, Republicans are always like, let's get some more weapons, let's be tougher, don't trust these people. And Democrats are always like, hey, can't we have a nice agreement? I mean, they look like we could share vodka with them and stuff. And so there was always a disagreement in this, but it worked for the administrations for Ike, for Kennedy, for Nixon, for Carter, for Reagan. And then we lost the Soviet Union for Ford. We lost the Soviet Union. When we lost the Soviet Union, we lost our adversary. We also lost our strategy. And during the 1990s, when I first met Kori and she was working in the Joint Staff, and I just came in from commanding the 1st Cavalry Division in Fort Hood, Texas, the first question I was asked is, what's the strategy? So this was like a test question. I went in to see General Schake, my boss, said, Wes, with his Polish accent, Wes, what is our strategy? I said, well, sir, I don't know. He said, go find out. So we ended up writing a strategy. It took us a year or so, and we finally published it. It was called The Strategy of Engagement and Enlargement. And we thought it was a really good product. We identified the nature of the challenges facing us in the post-Cold War environment, and it was erudite. The title sounded like an advertisement for a men's pharmaceutical product, honestly. But the real problem with it was that Americans weren't engaged in foreign policy. You know, the Cold War was over. There was no challenge out there. So we went our own way. And then, and we had a great decade in the 1990s. We created 22 million jobs. And even the median wage went up across America. Americans never had it so good. I remember when I retired, I stood on that parade field at Fort Myers, the summer of 2000, and I just thought, God, what a wonderful thing it is to be an American. And I just couldn't wait to get out in the private economy, our investment banking, the dot-com, the technology, all the things I've been watching and reading about all my life. I was 55 years old. I just wanted, just let me out there, coach. And, you know, we were on top of the world. And the armed forces were in such wonderful shape. And when I was a battalion commander at Fort Carson in 1980, the Europeans told us, guys, don't come back to Europe. Your troops, they're reckless. They're not disciplined. They're not educated like our troops. Really, it was embarrassing. Boy, nobody said that in 20 years later. There was no question. We were the top of the heap. And then 9/11 happened. And it was war. And